The next test I've chosen is one with a lot of controversy, in my opinion, but we're going to go for it. Compression testing. Now, I do agree that we have adopted and have adopted now for quite some time dynamic compression testing. Now, what I mean by dynamic compression testing is rather than using a compression gauge, which has a one-way valve, which captures and retains the pressure in the gauge whilst cranking the engine, is no longer appropriate. We want to see real-time evaluation of compression in engine whilst the engine's actually running under acceleration and deceleration, and also while the valve lifters, which are normally hydraulic, have the full oil pressure in them at the right viscosity. So it's real-time dynamic measurement using the scope with the fabulous little WPS. We love it to bits. But you know what? I mentioned the thing about accuracy, speed, process, simplicity. As accurate as this is, and as incredible this tool is, there are times I wouldn't want to pick it up. There are times I just use a gauge. And that's the controversy bit of some of what I'm going to say, because I've seen of late some incredibly gifted technicians use fabulous processes of applying the scope to make measurements which, quite frankly, you can do in a matter of seconds with a gauge. So I don't buy it. I'm going to be a little controversial. I've also seen a lot of compression testing predicting where bottom dead center is. Well, you know what? I've spent 15 years as a professional engine builder. That was my first profession, building everything from production to race engines. You cannot predict where valve timing is electronically. Let me explain why. In the past, I would agree with fixed valve timing, you could, because the valve timing didn't change. My car, Cupra R, uses AVS, Audi valve lift, where not only does the valve lift change, but the angle of opening and closing is also changed dependent on the duty cycle of the actuator. So where's bottom dead center? You actually don't know. There's too many parameters now change. You've got variable valve timing on both inlet and exhaust cams on some engine. You've got AVS lift change, where the base lift and the actual lift of the cam not only changes in terms of lift by 0.6, it also changes the angle by 13 degrees. Where's bottom dead center? I'm going to show you simplistically. So I'm going to do compression testing. So there's a bit of the controversy from my point of view. You know what, guys? If you really want to know where your valve timing is, take it apart and pin it, period. That's it for me. But I do agree with using the scope to predict that there is a problem. So I'd like to put my interpretation on compression testing, how I would view it, without over-egging it, basically. Right, WPS. First thing we need to select is range. It's charged. Power on. I think range one should be, yeah, up to 34 bar. You know what? I'm only expecting, well, no more than 10, 15 bar on this engine. So it's well within range. And let's connect the device. And we've adapted this device to our personal fittings. Everything we measure, water, air, fluid, diesel, petrol, all use the same fittings, so we're adaptive. I now need to select time base and range. So first of all, the device now, I'm using the channel 4. Black's a nice picture, it's a nice bold colour. Channel 4 input, I'm going to change it from, I'm going to break a habit of a lifetime now, and change from voltage, which I can actually keep. So you could use voltage, but I'm not going to. WPS, range 1 has been selected. Minus 4 to 34 bar is now displayed as actual pressure. And how long do we want in time base? Well, tell you what, just let's leave it as it is and see how it goes. We could switch every other channel off. Let's switch the others off. A, off. B, off. C, off, D channel only, full screen deflection. Let's start the engine, see what we've got. I think I'll shift the scaling up a little bit. We're not obviously not going to use all of the scaling. I'm going to increase the throttle. I've terminated the test as promptly as possible because it's incredibly difficult to get to the injectors. You know what? I've left it delivering fuel in the cylinder for what few seconds I've run the test. I'm interested in air pressure. Providing we don't suffer bore wash, which we're not going to in that short space of time, we're not going to affect pressure. Right, so here we have real-time pressure measurement in the cylinder. Let's simplify some of the conclusions. I said that you can try and become awfully overcomplicated in your assumptions. Let's first of all set a baseline. That is ground zero. So everything below that line is negative pressure, suction. Well, less than that. I don't like the word suction. We live on this planet at one bar. Outer space is zero, and we normally measure pressure between there and plus one bar above atmosphere. Two atmospheres absolute. So I like to think of this still as a pressure, but it's less than atmospheric. So as the piston comes down, it's going to create a negative pressure in the cylinder. Compression, of course, is fairly easy to look at. Positive pressure. And we're measuring here 2.8 bar, thereabouts. Doesn't sound an awful lot. Is it accurate? Well, the gauge is accurate, so we have to assume in real time that's what we're getting in the cylinder. It's even, for one. The controversy about where bottom dead centre is. Do you know, guys, how easy it is? I'm not going to use mathematics or any other form of complication. I am going to measure peak compression. Peak compression, 140 milliseconds between the two events. So 7 and 7 is 14. I'm going to move one to 70. 73, 72, 71, 70.61, near enough. Yo guys, that's where bottom dead centre is. That's how simple it needs to be. Now we can look at the events. So if we want, oh, there we go. So we know top dead centre's there, we know that's bottom dead centre. So this is the point where induction takes place. This is obviously the exhaust stroke. You can see there's a slight increase in pressure on the exhaust stroke. This is where the cylinder's sweeping down, where it comes up on compression. So this is the induction stroke. So how best are we going to interpret this, improving what's going on in the cylinder? Well, if all the valves were operating correctly, they've got to create all the amount of pressure. Does that mean the timing, the valve timing's correct? No, of course it could still be out. So how are we going to try and improve valve timing? Well, the way I might suggest is that on overrun with a closed throttle, in a perfect world, we should create absolute zero. Now, we're not going to do that, that's minus one bar. We're not going to do that, but we should come a good way towards it. So let's have a look at the event when we lifted off, because what happens here is a closed throttle at high speed. Now, because the throttle is closed, you can't pull in the same amount of air, so your compression value is going to drop. But we do create a hell of a lot more suction. So by looking at the negative value, that gives us an idea of how efficient suction is and whether there are any valves stuck open, because if any valves were stuck open, valve overlap, or the valve timing were out, or anything were wrong with the valve seats, then we're not going to get good suction properties. Now we're producing minus 642, so it's 0.6 of an atmosphere, 0.6 of a bar under atmosphere. Now that's just one cylinder, of course. If you did this measurement in the manifold, that would improve as per rotor, depending how many cylinders you've got. You create more vacuum. That's not a bad figure, to be honest. And they're all even, so it suggests there's no untoward leakage of suction and induction stroke. Obviously no compression, very little compression to speak of. So really that's the most accurate indication of valve performance. But it's just, you know, it's just a pointer, guys. I still would want to do real-time examination of valve timing, because we've got hydraulic actuators, we've got keyless mechanical systems now, where the sprocket and the cam don't have a mechanical relationship anymore. It's normally pinned and then assembled. We've got variable valve timing, and we've got variable valve lift with phasing shift as well, all of which is electronic controlled with infinitely, how can I put it, complex software. I mean, my car, it's a 2-litre car producing 380 horsepower from 2 litres. 35, 40 years ago, an engine builder, I would dream of producing that sort of power and a full race engine from 2 litres. Now you go into a showroom and you buy it with a cup of coffee in your hand. That's what technology and electronic controls brought us. So I'm honestly, guys, I am really quite nervous at trying to predict too much. I'm also being cautious with a scope. I love a scope, I'm enthusiastic, I'm sold. But I'm also tempered by the fact that be careful what you try to prove with a scope. Let's take a look on acceleration. Because we had an issue here that did prove the value of this test. The great thing with this test is we're not actually saving pressure in the tool. We've removed the one-way valve. We have one if we want to put one back in, but we remove the one-way valve. This is real-time measurement of air pressure during acceleration. And we had a BMW that had a misfire only on acceleration, only when cold. And when conducting this test, what we found, remarkably, was that each of these events is a singular compression. Remarkably, between each singular compression event, there was a dramatic difference in pressure attained in the engine. So it had to be losing pressure on a single event. Now, we wouldn't have found that with a normal compression gauge, because the one-way valve would have captured that pressure and added to it. So any drop in pressure would not have been noted. Obviously, the rise in pressure would have, the increase in pressure on compression would have been a factor, but not in real time. We couldn't run the engine. So there is a very good value of this test, of which I fully support, but please, when trying to establish valve timing from this test with the technology I've just presented to you, please be very cautious, because I don't really buy it. Now, of course, on acceleration, you don't get much suction. You tend to get an increase in pressure, and we can measure that directly off. We're reading just over 7 bar of pressure in the cylinder. So I love it as a test. We have adopted it as a standard test for compression testing in every single case. We don't use a gauge anymore, we do use the scope. So I do support the use of this test, and I love the WPS, it really is great. Other uses, would you use it on fuel pressure and turbo testing? I'm tempted to say not, guys. I think I'd go for a gauge in that case. Simplicity, speed, accuracy, always is the equation. If you want to make an accurate recording electronically, go WPS. So if you haven't got one, you really need one, guys. The sort of things we're measuring these days in real time demands these tools on a what I call an almost everyday basis.